we continue our journey to discover Puglia, and now we are in Otranto, the easternmost of all the Italian municipalities, bordering the Adriatic Sea. Otranto takes its name from the Latin term Odruntum. It's the city of water for excellence, among the most famous tourist resorts in Puglia for the beauty of its beaches, among the most beautiful villages of Italy, named by UNESCO World Heritage Witness of Culture and Peace, and also awarded for at least 5 years with the five sails of Legambiente. Among the most important monuments stands on the highest point the cathedral, built on the ruins of a Roman house, a Messapico village, and an early Christian temple, by the year 1080 under the Pope Gregory VII. Surmounts the imposing entrance gate, the emblem of the Archbishop Ardarzo of Santander, and the striking Renaissance rose window. The summary of different styles, from Romanesque to early Christian Byzantine Empire, the city's history, all packed inside. Captures the eye the magnificent coffered ceiling with wood-colored gold on a white and black background. But even more spectacular is the mosaic floor. Commissioned in 1163 by Jonata, Bishop of Otranto, it was created by the monk Pantaleone, who used multicolored tiles made of hard local limestone. It represents the human drama, constantly torn between good and evil, immersed in a struggle between vice and virtue. It has the shape of a Latin cross with three naves. The cathedral has a semicircular apse and two side chapels, and it houses valuable paintings and several tombs. Dedicated to the Virgin of the Annunciation, the cathedral is less than 54 meters long and is built on 42 monolithic columns with different quality granite and marble, but also different in terms of style and production time. Some of the columns are smooth, others are covered with grooves, others instead covered with rich and sophisticated decorations. Despite these differences, their wise layout in an area with many different materials and styles, however, allows a configuration of a substantially homogeneous space. But let's go back to admire the fabulous floor mosaics, a true work of unique art in the whole southern part of Italy, which luckily survived the Turkish invasion in 1480. First of all, it's surprising and extraordinary for its size. The mosaic, in fact, unfolds along the entire central nave and the side aisles, reaching the apse and the presbytery. The scenes depict clearly the echoes of the medieval imagination with a particular intense expression. The mosaic shows that East and West are just a distinction required by time and history. Just as Don Crazio Giaffreda wrote, they do not represent a clash between two cultures, but a compendium of one culture that knows how to maintain their identity through the changes imposed by the events. A true masterpiece. Well, a real book of life made in stone to be studied in all the smallest details. And the wonder is increased when in the right aisle, in seven large wall closets, we see from a distance at first, and then more and more clearly, the skulls and bones of the blessed martyrs of Otranto. 800 and more citizens slaughtered by the hands of the Turks in 1480 because they refused to renounce to their Christian faith, an event for which Otranto is also known as the Martyr City. We conclude our visit to the cathedral, down in the semicircular shaped Byzantine crypt, dating back to the 11th century. Roaming around the streets of the old town, we suddenly find ourselves in front of the Basilica of St. Peter, the most important example of Byzantine art in Puglia. The unadorned exterior appearance only adds suggestiveness to the interior and its frescoes of biblical narrative. Otranto is a fortified city. The town walls, which have survived the attacks of time and history, protect the inhabited area following the line of the waterfront. From here, from the height of the wall, you can enjoy some breathtaking views that consist of an immense expanse of blue sea beyond the village with its historical remains. Situated on a spur of tufa, which goes down to the sea, we find the small Church of the Holy Spirit, also known as the Chapel of Our Lady dell'Alto Mare. The church was built in 1600 and later restored in 1744 by the will of the people of Otranto, very devoted to the Virgin. The interior has a nave and is enriched with numerous decorations that recall the maritime vocation of the city, from a seahorse to a dolphin, from the anchor to the shell, which also refers to the concept and the idea of perfection. In the first week of September, the population of Otranto pays tribute to the Madonna dell'Alto Mare with solemn celebrations. And currently, the religious procession of the statue of the Virgin is the most important part of the celebration. We continue to explore the old town, walking along its narrow streets that open up from time to time to very picturesque views, while in the background you hear the gentle sound of waves breaking on the beach. Suddenly we find ourselves in front of the immensity of the Aragonese Castle. Located just opposite of the sea, the castle was built at the end of the 1400s by the Aragonese of Naples, probably on a previous Frederick construction. The castle has an irregular pentagon-shaped base and is provided along the perimeter of a moat originally equipped with a drawbridge. Impressive are the three cylindrical towers and bastion lapel, nicknamed Diamond Head, built in 1578, visible on the arms of Don Pedro from Toledo and Antonio de Mendoza. Meanwhile, on the gateway stands the emblem of Charles V of Habsburg. The plant is not the original one. In fact, from the beginning of the 1800s to the advent of the Napoleonic troops, nearly the whole defensive system of Otranto was tampered. Is a very ancient Apulian city, where many different evidences of the past come together in an harmonious synthesis. Existing settlements of the Neolithic era, the city was then populated by Messapes, then became a part of Magna Graecia. With the advent of the Romans, it became a city hall, and was considered one of the most important maritime cities of Apulia. In medieval times, Otranto was Byzantine and a Gothic center, then also Norman, Swabian, Angevin, and Aragonese.
Don't accept average habits. Open your heart and push.
In 1480, it was conquered by the Turks, and it was able to recover from the destruction only from the 1700s, and later on the Napoleonic period, when the city became a duchy of the Kingdom of Naples. After the 20th century migration of the local population directly to Germany and Switzerland in search of work, today Otranto is back to being one of the most popular small tourist towns, a tourist destination in the region thanks to its culture and above all to the sea, among the cleanest of Italy and a great source of wealth for the whole city. Here fishing is widely practiced, especially for mackerels, mullets, groupers, sea bream snappers, sea bass and exquisite sea urchins. Important is also the contribution of agriculture to the local economy, with major plantations of olive trees, grapevines, wheat, vegetables. Just as important is the contribution of crafts and the famous production of rattan baskets, mosaics, lucky bells, or even linens made with antique frames. South of the city, located right on the top of the peak of the hill of Minerva, in 1480, 800 martyrs of Otranto were beheaded. Here we seek the sanctuary of Santa Maria dei Martiri. Built in memory of the tragedy by Duke Alfonso of Calabria, it's accessible through a long staircase, flanked by two marble pillars with inscriptions recalling the tragic event. Of particular importance is also the altar, built in Baroque style, with the local Leccese stone. Among the altars and paintings, two very beautiful paintings. A canvas that depicts the massacre, dating back to the 16th century, made by the artist Lavinio Zoppi, and a large painting on the ceiling depicting the storming of the city by the Turks. Moving a little north of Otranto, we reach the Lake Alimini, an interesting natural area, a special preserved area, consisting of two lakes embraced by a band of rocks covered with thick pine forest, a Mediterranean vegetation, so-called macchia mediterranea. Alimini Piccolo, better known as Fontanelle, generated by fresh water coming from different sources, no more than 5 feet deep, and it features low and flat banks, and it's connected by a channel to the Alimini Great Lake, created by the continuing erosion of the sea, and it's deep about 4 meters. Symbols instead of the fauna of the lakes are numerous examples of coots and duns. From Lake Alimini, we move along the coast full of sandy beaches on which breaks a crystal clear blue sea. And proceeding along the coast, we reach in the Valley of Memories an apogeum of Torre Pinta, probably dating back to the Neolithic period. It has a Latin cross plant, consisting of a long hallway with a barrel vault, pierced by numerous small cells, probably originally intended to host the urns of the deceased, and then opens into a round space where the Devocate Tower of the 17th century rises. And finally moving towards south, the enchanting beauty of this beautiful coastline, about 25 kilometers long of sandy stretches, alternating with rocky ones above the sea, and dotted with numerous defensive towers built in the 16th century by Charles V to ward off attacks of the Saracens. An endless expanse of blue, which at precisely in Punta Palascia symbolically separates the Ionian Sea from the Adriatic Sea.